It's time to get lost in something. Everything is big. Ridiculously big. And not to wax loquacious about the universe like Douglas Adams, but I have never felt so small as when I think of just how little of this planet I've seen. I've never been anywhere, really. I haven't even been on a plane. Were you to track me from space, as one can these days, you would see a little dot never traversing more than a few hundred miles from the place of my birth. Take care to note the tight circles I make for some number of years, up and down one highway, around and around one rotary, the foot traffic that winds a campus, and the strangest is the steps that I take in place so that I can have energy and strength to make more circles in other places. Then I wait in line to find energy to burn in the form of tightly knit complex carbohydrates, polymer-wound nucleic acids, and pleated fats. In each one of these places, I may stand still and stare at a device that shows me other places that for a while, I cannot be. But really, I'm just checking to see if I've been notified of anything I didn't really want to know anyway. Then when that device is no longer working, I go in search of places to plug it in. It seems a strange thing that a great majority of my life is going in search of places to plug shit into shit and to find shit to stuff in my face, for I am essentially a giant tube, in one end and out the other. Even stranger still is that it's more important to find a plug than a toilet. Once the toilet has been found, I sit and stare at a device I just plugged in along some wall, along some circle, not very far from the place I was born. I take the stall even though I'm pissing, because goddammit, even at 35, I still can't piss near another guy. Even though sometimes there's a split second where a person can't tell if there's someone in the stall, so they peek to make sure. You see them peeking at you, and they see you seeing them. There's a realization between the two of you that what you have done is a necessary evil, and then they move on to the next stall. And it's there, squatting on the pond, that I think. The most mundane of tasks brings that out of me. For others, it's the shower. For me, it's the shitter. A life lived out of a pocket'll do that to you. A myriad of thoughts assail me as my hands are aflutter on the keyboard. To ask, where does the idiom, everything but the kitchen sink, come from? Apparently it's old, and originally it was said, everything but the stove. But the common usage of it came from the World War II effort to contribute the most steel as anyone could, with the exception of the kitchen sink. That was made of porcelain and could stay. Because of course back then the most valuable contribution a woman, who couldn't fight in the war, could make, was to be at home in front of one. Lately we've made efforts to ensure that they no longer get the shit end of the stick, the idiom used to describe a tool which was used to wipe your ass. And speaking of, I make a cursory wipe and a courtesy flush for my neighbor who was just peeking at me. And then back to my phone. The generation gone by with their strange idioms may think of my bathroom phone usage and ruminations as signs that the world is going straight to hell. Didn't you know, old ones, there is no hell? The internet told me so, and the only place we can go to is into our pockets for relief. When your whole life is have to, a few moments alone are enough to bring back the writer in me. I hear them say that when they were kids they didn't need warning labels because they weren't stupid. Yet they probably bore children in that generation that died from doing the stupid things that those warning labels are there for. We didn't need padding on playgrounds. We were smat. No, sir, your brain injury says differently. No, we're not living in a world gone awry from these technological horrors. You can see all of the things I see. It's a doorway to other worlds. While I sit on the pot and shit hoping my phone doesn't die, before me the most beautiful things in the world are the things that have been destroyed by you and everyone before you. There are sunsets on worlds you haven't seen, and never will. There are things you will not experience, but the more we share, the more we read, the more we see and speak, the better off we are. They say, what has it brought you? And I say, let me tell you a story before I'm done pinching one off. Somewhere between Star Wars A New Hope and Return of the Jedi, long before the internet was useful to regular people, two boys were born not far, far away from each other, but near enough that they should cross paths. They traverse along the normative middle-class circles not far from the place that they were born, each with the knowledge that they're different from most, and most know that they are different. Each personal circle comes so close, but even in a modern age when cell phones are not in prevalent use, they grow and blossom back to back, never knowing that a sharp turn or a party crashing could bring them closer. He knows the people he knows, and he knew people that he knew. It's a lot like a Groundhog Day version of Dr. Zhivago. They stand apart, facing the same stars, sometimes feeling the same wind. It wasn't until nearing their 40s they entered a digital circle, faces removed, that they met. Hello, my name is Atticus. and I feel like I've known you my entire life. A gentle night later, and a man who said love is the worst now says it's everything. Finally, I have someone to tell the things that occur to me in the middle of the night. I say, I think it's funny how most of modern human living involves keeping water and dirt from getting into a home unless you want it there. It's pacing around in more meaningless circles. I mean, it will just come back in again. He replies, as tired bedfellows do. It's nice to have someone who doesn't care if I fart in the bed. I love you.
I love you too.
So no, I'm not worried about what comes next. We've always lived in the moment. Nor am I worried that if the world were rid of technology that somehow everyone will have forgotten how to light fires without a cursory Google search or asking Siri. Hey Siri, can you tell me how to light a fire?
Okay, give me a moment. I found something on the web about can you tell me how to light a fire? Check it out.
Easy enough, huh? I finish my shit and walk the same beaten path not far from the place where I was born, in search of plugs, food, love, knowledge, a toilet seat, and of course, the kitchen sink. So tell me in the comments section, what has the internet brought you? Has it all been bad? Has it all been good? And by the way, if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe. Share it on Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, wherever.